On behalf of the International Christian Fellowship Portimao, I would like to welcome you all, and it's wonderful to know that we are being seen all around the world and that we are safe and comfortable in our own homes. I'm sure, like me, you all feel very blessed that we can have this lovely service every Sunday in our homes, and I think I would like to have a big thank you to Joy for doing this for us. It's a lot of work and a lot of research, and she's doing a great job. So Joy, thank you very, very much. It's really appreciated. And I hope that you all enjoy the service this week and that we will at some stage all be together again. Could we bow our heads and say a prayer? Gracious and almighty Heavenly Father, we give you thanks today for all the blessings you shower upon us. We give you thanks for all those people we have prayed for during this COVID-19 virus. And we have had lots of answers to the prayers. Lots of people have been healed and are doing well. And Lord, we thank you too that we have all coped during this lockdown period. And it's all with your help, Lord. And we give this service to you today in humble and grateful thanks. Amen.
Psalm 104. Praise the Lord, O my soul. O Lord, my God, you are very great. You are clothed with splendor and majesty. He wraps himself in light as with a garment. He stretches out the heavens like a tent and lays the beams of his upper chambers on their waters. He makes the clouds his chariot and rides on the wings of the wind. He makes winds his messengers, flames of fire his servants. He sets the earth on its foundations. It can never be moved. You covered it with the deep as with a garment. The waters stood above the mountains, but at your rebuke the waters fled. At the sound of your thunder, they took to flight. They flowed over the mountains. They went down into the valleys to the place you assigned for them. You set a boundary they cannot cross. Never again will they cover the earth. He makes springs pour water into the ravines. They flow between the mountains. They give water to all the beasts of the field. The wild donkeys quench their thirst. The birds of the air nest by the waters. They sing among the branches. He waters the mountains from his upper chambers. The earth is satisfied by the fruit of his work. He makes grass grow for the cattle and plants for man to cultivate, bringing forth food from the earth. Wine that gladdens the heart of man, oil to make his face shine, and bread that sustains his heart. The trees of the Lord are well watered, the cedars of Lebanon that he planted. There the birds make their nests. The stork has its home in the pine trees. The high mountains belong to the wild goats. The crags are a refuge for the conies. The moon marks off the seasons, and the sun knows when to go down. You bring darkness, it becomes night, and all the beasts of the forest prowl. The lions roar for their prey and seek their food from God. The sun rises and they steal away. They return and lie down in their dens. Then man goes out to his work, to his labor until evening. How many are your works, O Lord? In wisdom you made them all. The earth is full of your creatures. There is the sea, vast and spacious, teeming with creatures beyond number, living things both large and small. There the ships go to and fro, and the Leviathan which you form to frolic there. These all look to you to give them their food at the proper time. When you give it to them, they gather it up. When you open your hand, they are satisfied with good things. When you hide your face, they are terrified. When you take away their breath, they die and return to the dust. When you send your spirit, they are created, and you renew the face of the earth. May the glory of the Lord endure forever. May the Lord rejoice in his works. He who looks at the earth and it trembles, who touches the mountains and they smoke, I will sing to the Lord all my life. I will sing praise to my God as long as I live. May my meditation be pleasing to him as I rejoice in the Lord. But may sinners vanish from the earth and the wicked be no more. Praise the Lord, O my soul. Praise the Lord.
Thank you.
pray together. Dear Lord, we thank you so much that you really are such a great God. Lord, we worship you this day in various places scattered all over the world. From the comfort and quietness of our homes, we come into your presence and we worship you. We give you thanks, Almighty God, for being such a great and wonderful Lord. And thank you, Lord, that you've made yourself known to us through the Lord Jesus. You're not just a distant God far away, but you're right here with us. And so, Lord, we praise you for the privilege we have of worshiping you this day. And Lord, as we come to this time to open your word, I just pray that you would speak to us, that you would quieten our hearts, help us to be attentive to your still, small voice. And I pray, Lord, that you would open your word to us today and make it come alive for each of us and speak to us. In your precious name we pray. Amen. Psalm 104 has been one of my favorites for many, many years. When I was about 16, my dad suggested to me that I could make a slideshow to illustrate it. And so in those days, long ago, long before the internet, I had fun going through all of my pictures and picking out ones which I thought illustrated this psalm. And so it's always been one of my favorites and one which is close to my heart. It really is a glorious poem. Psalm 104 is one that stands out in the Psalter like a lofty mountain peak high above many of the others surrounding it. And it's just absolutely beautiful in its expression and its detail. It's a wonderful psalm to read aloud, especially when you're in a beautiful place. I remember one day last year in October, in the days when you could still walk on the beaches here in Portugal, I went down to the Portimao in Ferragudo and walked out onto the jetty just as the sun was setting. And there were only a few fishermen around, nobody very close. And so I took out my phone as I watched the sunset and I read aloud Psalm 104. And it just really came to life for me. I thought, wow, the sunset really illustrates this psalm in a beautiful way. And it made me wonder if perhaps David had even written it at sunset. Psalm 104 mirrors God's handiwork in creation. Verses 1 to 4 speak of light and God stretching out the sky as in the first 2 days of the Genesis account. Verses 5 to 18 cover the separation of dry land from the sea, the formation of rain, brooks and rivers, the growing of trees and vegetation, all reflecting day 3 of creation. Verses 19 to 23 tell us of the sun and moon, guardians of the sky, made on day 4 of creation. Verses 24 to 30 speak of all the living creatures that fill the air, sea and land, paralleling days 5 and 6 of creation. Man is only mentioned briefly in verse 24, but he's also represented by the psalmist himself, who is singing his praises to God. And then finally, verses 31 to 35 reflect the time of Sabbath rest at the end of creation, as God rejoices in the works of his hands, and the psalmist praises him for all that he has made. It really is a magnificent psalm. It's recited every day by devout Jews at their time of morning prayer. It's a hymn of praise to Almighty God for the delightful world that he has made. Anglican Bishop Christopher Wordsworth, who was the nephew of the famous poet William Wordsworth, called this psalm an Oratorio of Creation. And I've borrowed his title today because it's a very fitting one. All of the voices of nature from earth, sea and sky, and ours too, join in praise to our wonderful Lord and Creator, who made us and provides for us all. So first of all, we have light and sky. This is verses 1 to 4, representing days 1 and 2 of creation. The first line, "Bless the Lord, O my soul," is a call to worship. These same words form both the beginning and the end of the psalm, encircling it with praise and reminding us of its sole purpose, and that is to bring glory to God. It's generally assumed to be a psalm of David, since it begins and ends, like Psalm 103, with these words, "Bless the Lord, O my soul." And since the previous psalm is ascribed to him, it's assumed that Psalm 104 is also. The poet begins, "O Lord my God, you are very great." And these words sum up the entire poem. Everything that is said supports this exclamation of wonder and shows in great detail why it is true. The natural world is an exceedingly beautiful place, and all the praise goes to its almighty Creator God. You know, when we hear an exquisite symphony by Beethoven, we say what a wonderful musician he is. Or when we look at a magnificent painting by Monet or some other artist that you love, you say, oh, what a magnificent work. And it's the same with God's handiwork in creation. As we look around at the beautiful world he has made, our hearts should sing, wow, what a wonderful God made all this for us. The psalmist paints a superb picture of the heavenly King in all his glory. Now, the original text shows us that the principal thought here is, you are clothed with splendor and majesty. In Hebrew, this is the main verb, and all the other actions listed in verses 2 and 3 are just participles stemming from that main verb, showing us some of the ways in which God's royal splendor is seen. In other words, we could translate it, you are clothed with splendor and majesty, wrapping yourself in light, stretching out the heavens, laying the beams of your chambers, making the clouds your chariot, riding on the wings of the wind. It's a picture that highlights in every way the royal splendor of the heavenly King. Now, a human monarch would clothe himself in robes of satin or velvet, but the King of Heaven wraps himself in resplendent light, which he himself has created. When I watch the scarlet, lilac, and gold swaths of color sweeping across the evening sky, I realize just how fitting a sunset is to describe the dazzling robes of the King of Heaven. Once the sun has disappeared below the horizon, we can no longer see it, but its presence and glory is still felt as the brilliant colors radiate across the sky. And in the same way, we cannot at present see the heavenly King himself, but signs of his glory are everywhere. His works reveal the majesty and wonder of his character. Just as every monarch has a palace, God our King stretches out the vast canvas of the heavens like a tent for his lofty dwelling place. His royal chariot is the clouds as they race across the sky, drawn by the rushing wind. His servants are mighty angels, bright as blazing fire. They sang at creation when God made the world. In Job 38, verses 4 to 7, God asks us, where were you when I laid the earth's foundations? Tell me if you understand. Who marked off its dimensions? Surely you know. Who stretched a measuring line across it? On what were its footings set? Or who laid its cornerstone while the morning stars sang together and all the angels shouted for joy? The first four verses of Psalm 104 are a magnificent description of the King in all his glory, and they've inspired some wonderful hymns. Listen to these words, which you'll recognize, by Robert Grant. Oh, worship the King, all glorious above. Oh, gratefully sing his power and his love. Our shield and defender, the Ancient of Days, pavilioned in splendor and girded with praise. Oh, tell of his might, oh, sing of his grace, whose robe is the light, whose canopy space. His chariots of wrath the deep thunderclouds form, and dark is his path on the wings of the storm. What beautiful words, inspired by a truly beautiful psalm. And now secondly, we come to dry land and sea, streams and vegetation. This is in verses 5 to 18. Genesis 1:9 tells us that on day 3 of creation, God said, "Let the water under the sky be gathered to one place, and let the dry land appear." Here in the psalm, we see the very same thing in poetic form. At first, the mountains were covered with water like a garment, but at the Lord's command, the waters fled away, rushing down the mountainsides into the valleys, forming streams and allowing dry land to emerge. A further command from the Lord gave the waters boundaries that they could not cross. I'm always amazed when I watch the tide come in. The water steadily rises up the beach, with each wave bringing it higher and higher, and then it stops. The waves break in the same place for a few minutes, and then the tide starts to go out again. And it's as if there's an invisible barrier there that the waters cannot cross. God set it up. He knows where it is, and the waves obey. I'm reminded of the words of Jesus' disciples who said of their master, "Who is this that even the wind and waves obey him?" Then verse 10 speaks of springs and God's provision of fresh water to drink, filling the streams and rivers, supplying the needs of people and animals alike. Water is vital to life, and we couldn't survive without it. Wild donkeys gladly quench their thirst. The birds of the air gratefully nest by the waters and sing happily among the branches. And here we have a lovely picture of contentment as all nature rejoices in God's gracious gift and generous provision for their needs. And then in verse 13, we see rain falling from God's upper chambers, the clouds. The rain nourishes the land and makes it fruitful, causing grass to spring up for the cattle. And here we see God's gift of plants, which man can cultivate and use for food. Among these are wheat, made into bread to satisfy our hunger, vines from which we harvest grapes and make wine, and olive trees, which give us both olives and their precious oil. And these are just a few examples of plant life, showing us God's bounty in providing our food. Then in verse 16, we see God's gift of trees, full of sap and bursting with goodness. As well as giving us a huge variety of delicious fruit, trees also produce many aromatic resins that we can use in medicines and perfume. Trees also clean our air, give us shade, oxygen and wood. They provide a safe place for birds to build their nests. God has thought of everything. The natural world is his garden. The trees are his, and he waters them and tends to them. Then verse 17 mentions storks. We know that these birds love the Algarve as much as we do. And they're fascinating to watch, whether it's carrying twigs in their beaks to build their nests, or feeding their young, or teaching them to fly as they let them hover overhead and land on their backs. And here in the Algarve, we see storks and their nests in many places. Among the most popular are old chimneys or electricity pylons or the roofs of old ruined buildings. But verse 17 speaks of the stork making its home in the pine tree. Now, I've only ever seen a stork's nest in a pine tree once, And it wasn't here in the Algarve. It was many years ago when we lived in Cáceres in Spain. And one day I was sitting outside the hospital and I was watching the storks flying overhead, and I noticed that several of them landed in the trees opposite me. And it was a cluster of pine trees. I believe they were Aleppo pines, which have long horizontal branches and they grow to a great height. They're very tall, sturdy trees. And I realized that there on each tree, there were four or five storks' nests in each tree. And it was absolutely amazing just watching the storks fly in at close range where you could see every detail, and flying in, navigating the branches and landing into their nests to feed their young. And it was just absolutely wonderful to watch. But this is how the psalm talks of the stork. It talks about the stork in the pine trees. And then verse 18 reminds us that God provides a shelter for all his creatures. The high mountains are a refuge for the wild goats. The rocky crags provide a home for the conies or wild rabbits. No creature is too small for the Lord to notice or care for. They're all his. You may remember the words of Jesus in Matthew 6:26, which say, "Look at the birds of the air. They do not sow or reap or store away in barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them." God graciously, generously provides for all his creatures. And then thirdly, we come to the sun and moon. This is verses 19 to 23. This represents day four of creation. Verse 19 says, "The moon marks off the seasons." Now, this isn't referring to the seasons as we normally speak of them, spring, summer, autumn, and winter. Those are caused by the tilt of the earth towards the sun. Rather, verse 19 is referring to seasons in the sense of time. In Jewish thought, the moon is very important as a timekeeper. Whenever there is a new moon, there is also a new month. Whenever there's a full moon, they know they're halfway through the month. And so for them, looking up at the moon is like us looking at the calendar. Jewish feast days are based on the moon. Rosh Hashanah is a minor festival celebrated every time there is a new moon. Passover, a major Jewish festival, always begins with a full moon on the 15th month of the Jewish month of Nisan. And our Christian celebration of Easter is in fact also based on the moon, as it is celebrated on the first Sunday after the first full moon that falls either on or after the vernal equinox, which is March the 21st. Now that sounds very complicated, and it is, but it does show that we too have an important festival which is marked by the moon. And then verse 19 continues, "The sun knows when to go down." The sun is also a very reliable timekeeper. And from ancient times, people have used it to tell the time by means of obelisks, shadow clocks, and sundials. In Jewish thought, the going down of the sun was particularly important because it signals the beginning of each new day. Unlike ours, their day begins at sunset and ends at sunrise, the opposite of ours. You'll remember the words in Genesis 1, "It was evening and it was morning, the first day, the second day," and so on. That's said at the end of each of God's days of creation. It was evening and it was morning. As the Lord of all creation, God has brought wonderful order and rhythm into his universe, like a composer creating a musical score. Nothing happens by chance, but it's all minutely orchestrated and planned down to the last detail. Verse 20 reminds us that even darkness is a blessing from God, allowing us to take a break from our work and have some time to rest. Imagine how difficult it would be to sleep if the sun shone both day and night. Darkness also allows an opportunity for the wild beasts to come out and hunt for their prey. Verse 21 says, "The lions roar and seek their food from God." These wild beasts may look ferocious to others, but they still depend on God for their food. He is their ultimate provider. To him, their roar is like a cat's meow to us, telling us when they're hungry. And as the sun rises, the lions retreat to their dens to rest, and man begins his work. We see a beautiful harmony and balance here in God's world. There is a time and place for everything. People and animals alike have a time to work and a time to rest. What a gracious God we have, who provides for all of our needs. At this point in the psalm, the poet breaks out in spontaneous praise to God. How many are your works, O Lord? In wisdom you've made them all. The earth is full of your creatures. And as the poet surveys the garden of the Lord, he becomes lost in wonder. God's works of creation are great, both in number and in variety. No two species of flower, tree, bird, or animal is alike. There is infinite variety, showing the careful design and exquisite taste of a master artist. What a great God he is. All of his works are designed with wisdom, crafted with his care, created with his power, and sustained with his love. And it makes us wonder, if earth is so full of beauty and goodness, what will heaven be like? When we've been there for about 1,000 years, we'll still be exploring it and discovering all the wonders that God has made there for us to enjoy. And then fourthly, we come to all living creatures. This is verses 24 to 30 and parallels days 5 and 6 of creation. Now we realize here that the psalmist hasn't actually kept to a strict outline because he's already mentioned animals a few times already. But that's okay, because this is poetry and it's coming from his heart. In Psalm 50, verses 10 to 11, God reminds us, every animal of the forest is mine, and the cattle on 1,000 hills. I know every bird in the mountains, and the creatures of the field are mine. Just as we care for our pets, we feed them, we bring them in out of the cold and rain, so too God takes care of all his animals. They're like his pets, and not one of them escapes his notice. Remember the words of Jesus in Matthew 10:29. Are not 2 sparrows sold for a penny? Yet not one of them falls to the ground outside your Father's care. Here in the fourth section, the psalmist surveys the sea, teeming with creatures beyond number. Now, I don't know if you've ever had the privilege of going snorkeling, but it's an amazing experience to realize that there's another whole world under the sea that most of the time we're oblivious to. There are brightly colored fish that flash in the sunlight in the most amazing iridescent colors. There are exquisite corals that have been carved by the hand of a master craftsman. The sea contains many, many creatures of outstanding natural beauty. And in addition to the smaller creatures, there are also the larger sea animals, such as the whale, referred to here as the Leviathan, which plays and frolics in the waves as the ships sail past. God provides for all living things of the sea, land, and sky. Verse 27 says, these all look to you to give them their food at the proper time. Like a caring pet owner, God opens his hand and feeds his creatures personally, lovingly. He didn't just make them and provide a place for them to live, but he also provides an abundance of food for them and personally cares for each one. Verses 29 and 30 show us that God is the giver of all life. When you hide your face, they are terrified. When you take away their breath, they die and return to the dust. But when you send your spirit, they are created, and you renew the face of the earth. Although the old passes away and dies, new life is continually springing up. Petals fall from flowers, but new buds open up. Old leaves die off in the autumn, but are replaced by bright new ones in the spring. God is continually renewing the earth and creating new life. And then finally, the fifth section, Sabbath rest. And here in the last part of the psalm, we see a reflection of God resting on the seventh day after he has completed his wonderful work of creation. In verse 31, the poet exclaims, "May the glory of the Lord endure forever. The fame of man is short-lived. An athlete is only a star for a few years and then it's over. But the glory of the Lord goes on and on forever." When we've been praising him in heaven for 10,000 years, his glory will be just as brilliant as when we first arrived. David continues in verse 31, "May the Lord rejoice in the works of his hands." And Genesis 1 tells us that everything God made was very good. And it's as if God is standing back here like an artist admiring his finished painting. I'm reminded of the words in Zephaniah 3:17, which says, "The Lord your God is with you. He is mighty to save. He will take great delight in you. He will quiet you with his love. He will rejoice over you with singing." What an amazing thought that God delights in us as part of his creation. And then verse 32 reminds us of his power. "He who looks at the earth and it trembles, who touches the mountains and they smoke." Here we have a passing reference to Exodus 19:20, when the Lord descended on Mount Sinai to speak with Moses, and the whole mountain was covered with smoke. God is not only a loving, generous provider, but he's also a powerful God who should be obeyed. And that's why David continues in verse 35, "May sinners vanish from the earth and the wicked be no more." Those who don't acknowledge the Lord are the only blot on God's perfect canvas. And so the psalmist looks forward to the day when there will be a new heaven and a new earth with no blemish at all caused by man. And David then concludes in verse 33, "I will sing to the Lord all my life. I will praise my God as long as I live. May my meditation be pleasing to him as I rejoice in the Lord." And what a wonder it is that although God is so great, so powerful, so majestic and wise, he loves and cares for each of us, and we can know him in return. And so here we see David's personal response to the wonderful Lord of creation, the Creator, Provider and sustainer. Just as God provides for us every day of our lives, so we too should thank him every day of our lives for his love and his goodness. And all this leads to a glorious crescendo of praise as the poet repeats his opening exclamation, "Bless the Lord, O my soul." And here he makes a perfect circle. And then he adds, "Hallelujah." And this is the first time that this expressive word appears in the Psalter. What a glorious hymn of praise to God this is. It's cosmic in its scope, including both light and darkness, the heavens and the earth, the sea and the dry land, plants and animals, life and death. It's a poetic account of God's amazing creation of our world. And it shows us that he's not just a wise and powerful creator, but he's also a loving and gracious sustainer who provides for all of our needs. And so when we feel the cares of this life starting to crowd in and overwhelm us, let's remember that he is the Lord, the same Lord who sets limits for the sea. In the same way, he won't give us more than we can handle. He is in control. And when we start to worry that we won't have enough money or energy or time to do the things that we need to, let's remember that he's the gracious God who provides for every living thing on the face of the earth. And he has promised to supply all of our needs in the Lord Jesus. So we can have confidence in him, that just as he cares for the rest of his creation, he also cares for us. Amen. Let's pray together. Dear Lord, we thank you today for your beautiful creation, which you have made for us to enjoy. And we give you our praise and our thanks. And Lord, we thank you that you're not just the creator, but you're also the sustainer. You didn't just make the world and leave it, but you provide for the needs of every living thing. And we thank you, Lord, how you provide for our needs. And Lord, today we thank you especially how you've provided for our needs in salvation by sending the Lord Jesus to be our Savior. And because of him, we can know you personally. We can know you as our Lord and as our Savior. Oh, Lord, we give you our thanks today and we worship you. We praise you. We thank you for all that you've done for us. And Lord, we commit to you those with special needs at this time. We continue to pray for those who are ill, who are fighting the coronavirus. We pray for strength, Lord, for those who are recovering. We pray for wisdom for the doctors and nurses. We pray too for wisdom for our leaders of our countries, that they might make wise decisions as they reopen their economies. And Lord, we pray for countries which are still experiencing a great deal of loss of life. We think of Brazil, we think of Russia, we think of countries in Africa. Lord, there's still many places where the epidemic is still at its peak. And so, Lord, we lift up those places to you especially and just pray that you would have mercy on the people and that you would especially help those who are ill, that you would give them the strength, Lord, to fight this terrible virus. And, Lord, we pray today for the scientists who are seeking to come up with a vaccine. We pray, Lord, that you'd give them great wisdom, that you'd give them great skill, help them in the tests that they carry out, the clinical trials with different viruses that they are making, different vaccines that they're making. Lord, give them wisdom, give them skill, and please give them success. We do pray, Lord, for a speedy production of a vaccine that would relieve many of the situations in our world, would relieve suffering, would relieve fear for the future as well, as we seek to return to normal. Lord, thank you. Thank you for this time to worship you this day. We praise you, Lord, for all that you've done. We praise you for all that you are. We praise you for all that you mean to each one of us. And Lord, we thank you for each one who's joined us today in worship. We ask your special blessing on all of the people watching this video today as they come to worship you together. Thank you, Lord, that although we can't see you and we can't see each other, we know that both you and our other brothers and sisters in the Lord Jesus are here with us in worship. And Lord, we give you our grateful thanks today for being such a wonderful and almighty God. In your precious name we pray, Lord Jesus. Amen.
Lord Jesus, Jesus is pure.